Today I want to talk about a concept that students have a lot of difficulty with, and that is the idea of receptor selectivity. Receptor selectivity is what allows us to develop drugs that are selective for particular sites of action. So you can make a drug that might bind only in the pupil of the eye, and not have anything to do with your heart or lungs, right? So having specific drugs for specific target organs requires that we have somewhere in that target organ a receptor or an enzyme, some kind of protein that can bind the drug that we've developed. If you recall, acetylcholine receptors sit on skeletal muscle, and the way that your muscle contracts is that you have a nerve which goes to that muscle that releases a neurotransmitter called acetylcholine, and acetylcholine then binds the acetylcholine receptor, which then causes the skeletal muscle to contract through a variety of mechanisms. Okay, so what's interesting is that there are receptors that bind acetylcholine all over the body, and we would never even have known that there were different kinds of acetylcholine receptors throughout your body, except for when people started trying out different drugs. So acetylcholine receptors come in two main flavors, which are nicotinic and muscarinic. Muscarinic receptors tend to be on autonomic organs. So think of it as organs. So the eye, the heart, the lungs, the GI tract, the bladder, those are places where you can find muscarinic receptors. Nicotinic receptors tend to be those receptors you've already studied, which are the receptors that sit on muscle, as well as receptors that sit in autonomic ganglia. So I think of the nicotinic M-type receptors as being the ones that are on skeletal muscle, and the nicotinic N receptors as being ones that are on nerves, hence the M for muscle and N for nerve. So if we know that acetylcholine has a variety of actions throughout your body, including contraction of skeletal muscle, activation of autonomic ganglia, and actions on different organs within your body, you might say, well, you can't really use acetylcholine as a drug because it would do everything. There are different kinds of acetylcholine receptors in different parts of the body, and we can use that to our advantage when we're developing a drug. So let's just look at three things that acetylcholine does in the body. Acetylcholine causes your pupil to constrict, does a lot of other things, but let's point out that it does that. It causes skeletal muscles to contract, and it also activates autonomic ganglion and the adrenal medulla. If you give nicotine to a patient or animal or whatever, you'll see the skeletal muscle contraction, and you'll see the activation of autonomic ganglia, the nerves, but you won't see the pupillary constriction. So what? Right? Because we knew acetylcholine did all those things. If nicotine is an agonist, it should be doing all the same things that acetylcholine does. Similarly, when you use a drug in a lab called muscarine, which is a molecule that you can find in mushrooms, which is again supposed to be like acetylcholine in terms of it's got part of its structure looks like acetylcholine, so it could fit into that same receptor. If you give a patient muscarine, what happens is you're affecting only the pupil of the eye, and you don't have an effect on autonomic ganglia and the skeletal muscle. So how can that be? How can you have drugs that are agonists of a particular neurotransmitter, and it doesn't do all the things a neurotransmitter would do in the body? Because acetylcholine does all those things in your body. And that's one of the ways that people realized that the receptors for particular neurotransmitters are not the same everywhere in your body. There's tons of different receptors in your brain. If we sort of don't talk about the brain itself, there are receptors for all the different kind of neurotransmitters and signaling molecules in your body, but those are slightly different depending on what organ or body system you're talking about. All right, so now here's a graphic. It's an abstract picture of acetylcholine, but the idea is always going to be the same, that there is an actual physical acetylcholine binding in a receptor. So it's always a lock and key model. All right, so here's acetylcholine binding acetylcholine receptors. And here's nicotine, and here's muscarine. All right, so if we know that nicotine only affects the skeletal muscle and the nerve ganglia, right? Then we know that nicotinic receptors that fit that molecule are found in those two spots, in the skeletal muscle throughout your body, and in those autonomic ganglia. Whereas muscarin, right? Muscarin, which is, looks like acetylcholine, since that only affects those organs in your body that have to do with the parasympathetic nervous system, we know that that particular receptor, the muscarin receptor, is only in those particular organs. Now, we can take, that's not even the whole story, because there's actually more subtypes. It turns out that there's at least five different subtypes of muscarinic receptor. And one of the subtypes is found in the heart, one is found in other autonomic nervous system organs of your body, another one is found in the CNS, which is great because the more specific you can make a drug to bind a specific receptor, the less side effects you're going to have. And let me go through an example of that. So let's, again, do a thought experiment where we're going to develop a drug that binds muscarinic receptors, because we know that muscarinic receptors are found in the eye to make the pupil get small. And muscarinic receptors are also found in your heart, where they slow your heart down. So you can make a drug that binds any kind of muscarinic receptor. So what's going to happen if a patient takes this new drug you developed? If it binds any kind of muscarinic receptor, it's going to make their pupil small and it's going to make their heart slow down. Well, sometimes you only want to make the heart slow down and you don't want the pupils to get small, right? So if you can make a drug which specifically binds only the receptor that binds in the heart, then you could use that drug to help slow down a person's heart rate without having to worry that it's going to screw up their pupils. You can't have tiny pupils in certain situations. It makes it difficult to see. All right, so in this video, we talked about a number of important concepts. We talked about the idea of receptor selectivity and how that helps us get drugs to the site of action that we want. I also introduced you to the receptor subtypes for acetylcholine, the nicotinic and the muscarinic receptor subtypes.